ladies and gentlemen, to our first edition of the CAW Newscast. I'm C.Carter, your host. Last night we had a discussion on various topics concerning the WWE as well as the upcoming DCA event, Revelations, Last Rites, and stick around. Towards the end of the show, we'll have the link to their live stream, which will take place this coming Saturday evening, so stick around. But first and foremost, last night, we spoke about what happened at the WWE Royal Rumble, and here's some parts of the conversation in which we discussed.
But on the serious note, I think that, you know, you really can't blame the Philly crowd for what happened last night. I mean, they were just voicing their displeasure, and apparently, canceled WWE Network became the highest trending.
Oh dear God in heaven!
It was trending. I watched it
worldwide.
All night. It was trending after the pay-per-view, and then this morning it was still trending, and it didn't stop trending until the beginning of Raw, which I was surprised.
And apparently WWE stocks took a tumble.
Mm-hmm.
Because at the end of the closing bell,
they didn't like Roman.
Go ahead, Steven.
Before we get into the Rumble, because that's what we're probably going to talk about the most, we can all agree that Triple Threat match was probably the most intense Triple Threat match you could ever possibly see today.
Oh, no question. As I said, numerous times, the Triple Threat match stole the show. The Royal Rumble match killed the pay-per-view.
Yeah, the Triple Threat should have been the main event.
That's true, but I think we all could agree that that matchup, when it was Seth Rollins, he did that top rope move, and some assurance for Michael Cole on some of the moves with some of the superstars doing the WWE. Cause I don't think that was
Where Michael Cole said it was a corkscrew moonsault when it was actually a corkscrew, like 450 splash.
Wait a minute. He screwed up calling it a corkscrew moonsault.
Yeah. Right.
Clearly, a corkscrew 450.
It was a corkscrew moonsault maneuver.
Are you kidding me?
Doesn't he know that a moonsault, you start off facing backwards? I know, exactly. So how is that a moonsault?
But he twisted around and he went into a corkscrew and then into a 450.
Mm-hmm.
How is that a corkscrew moonsault? Please explain this to me, somebody.
I don't know. I think Michael Cole just forgot his moves, that's all.
That's because he's never seen it. He had to call it something.
I don't think any of us have, actually seen that. Oh, my God. In a period of 5 minutes, hashtag canceled WWE Network has become the top trend once again.
Why?
I don't know. I just... I think they just saw the replay
of what happened. Oh.
Now Reigns is... Now it's not even on there. What the heck?
But I think let me interject here. I think that this is what I think the main problem with the pay per view last night was. The main problem is this: you got some of Daniel Bryan's fans. As soon as Daniel Bryan got eliminated, that's when the show went downhill in a hurry, because that Philly crowd, they booed almost every superstar that came out of that curtain. The only people that got cheers were. The only handful that got chills was Diamond Dallas Page, the Boogeyman, Dean Ambrose, and Dolph Ziggler.
And Jack Swagger.
Yeah.
And Ryback when he took down Roman Reigns.
No, Ryback got booed. Ryback got booed.
Well, once he took down Roman Reigns, he got cheered.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
WWE has a problem, and even The Rock can't save the show.
When the fans are booing The Rock, you know you have an issue.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
Rock's always been the guy who could not turn heel because the crowd kept on cheering him. And then he went to Philly, and he was like, wait a minute, I'm not used to this.
I mean, if you look at it, Daniel Bryan, all those Daniel Bryan fans are from Philly because that's where guys like Daniel Bryan, CM Punk, AJ Styles, that's where they all grew up, in the Philly. Well, not mostly Daniel Bryan, but, you know, Ring of Honor, when they mostly came from, Ring of Honor was mostly in Philly during that time.
Mm-hmm.
Smart capital of the world. I mean, you had the Smarks from ECW, then you had the Smarks from Ring of Honor, and they're all camped around that one little area in Philly, and you expect them to be fine with Daniel Bryan being eliminated that early.
Hmm.
No, they aren't going to do that.
No. They're going to whine and complain and bitch. They're not going
to take
it.
They took it to Twitter, and as a result, canceled WWE Network became the highest trending thing on Twitter all night long all the way up until the morning.
That was just crazy. It was I got back today. It went on until like 6.
I mean, if it would have helped, if they knew, and WWE said they knew because they had backup plan with The Rock, if they knew that Roman Reigns was going to get booed out of the arena and they knew that they were going to start booing once Daniel Bryan got eliminated, should have acted fast, had Seth Rollins cash in after his match. That way he could face either maybe Daniel Bryan or Dolph Ziggler or Dean Ambrose at WrestleMania, or the Triple Threat Shield match.
Yeah, which I have been constantly saying.
Which could still happen. It could still happen.
Say, they Raw could save it. In on an episode of Raw.
No, they can cash. He can do it either on the live SmackDown, or at Fastlane if Brock Lesnar's there.
Yeah, because Lesnar's going to be on the live SmackDown. Rollins could attack him, like just dominate him from behind.
Yeah,
because
remember he's got broken ribs apparently.
Yeah, they could use that, and then it could go on to the fact that Dean Ambrose is constantly attacking Seth Rollins. Rollins says, give me Dean, leading to a triple threat match at Mania, which I think would be just downright incredible.
And that would save the fact that Reigns is in the match.
That would save everything. That would save everyone completely. Mm-hmm. It would be an amazing match.
Nobody would complain about Reigns being in it because Rollins and Ambrose would be right there.
That's right.
But here's the problem. Yeah, but here's the problem. Vince McMahon.
No, Vince McMahon is going to have to do something. Even I read today that Vince McMahon knows he has to do something. Because
he knows
what happened last night and what's happened in the last 24 hours has got to change something. Because if you have canceled WWE Network, being the highest rated Twitter handle for, you know, in who knows how long, plus the fact that you had so many people that night, so many people trying to go onto the unsubscribe page to unsubscribe from the network. It caused it to crash. You had Philly's fans blocking the talent from leaving the building last night.
I read that The Usos' car, the vehicle that they were in, a fan attacked the vehicle with one of the steel chains
that they had. Jimmy got out. Jimmy got out, and he just... Oh, man. Jimmy's a freaking boss.
Yeah,
got out and said, you want to come fight me? This isn't wrestling. This is real life. And that dude hightailed it.
Mm-hmm.
This the thing. And I think this is what Vince McMahon has failed to realize. And we brought this up numerous times again and again and again. Vince McMahon is out of touch.
Stay tuned. We have more of the CAW Roundtable in just a moment. Welcome back to the CAW Roundtable. Let's continue on with the conversation from wherever our fellas left off.
He's so out of touch, it's not funny. And I can't believe some of the stuff that he has pulled. And you also got it, Steven. I know you don't like it, but we also got to look at those Daniel Bryan fans who hijacked the show and just took over and just started raising hell ever since Daniel Bryan got eliminated.
I said it all day. If WWE was smart business-wise, money-wise, and viewership-wise, they would put Bryan in the investment with so much merchandise out of him. They would get a lot of buys and a lot of subscriptions to the WWE network. He's so over right now, it's not even funny.
Again, I point to you the problem. Vince McMahon.
And I know people are saying, oh, well, we saw Daniel Bryan in the main event last year. Yeah, and it was a pretty good damn main event, in my opinion.
Yeah, it was a very good matchup. And I think this is also another thing which I think we had to consider. WWE has to understand that. I mean, you at least think that, you at least hope they would listen to their fans. And it clearly shows us that they're not listening to their fans whatsoever. Don't care what they're saying. Do whatever the heck we want. And D-Wall raised a valid point. When Kane and the Big Show got rid of all the remaining faces, except for Roman Reigns, but when they got rid of Dean Ambrose and Dolph Ziggler, that's what caused the fans to go in a complete uproar. And it's just causing me angry. And I have to be honest, I think that somewhere backstage, even Miss McMahon has to be upset, has to be ever even desperate, because those fans were just booing the roof off the building.
So maybe this blizzard was the best thing for them to get, like, to have at least a few days of planning to get together. Like, okay, what are we going to do?
Well, I can go ahead and tell you that this Thursday on the live episode of SmackDown, we have a casket match between Daniel Bryan and Kane. So, we're going to
If they go with this, sorry to cut you off. If they go with this, it's going to be Daniel Bryan and Kane at WrestleMania. That's what I'm going to call for.
I just don't know what WWE's trying to pull. They're probably thinking that it's gonna be on live dish or SmackDown. It's gonna be in Hartford, Connecticut, once they get rid of all that snow. But it's just that you gotta really wonder what's Vince McMahon trying to do. What's his goal here? Because he's out of touch. And they have to pay
here's the thing that I read just a few minutes ago. Apparently, Vince still considers Bryan a high priority because You know, hold on. Let me find it. Let me find the exact thing here. Because I saw it, and I was like, okay. But, gotta try and find it real quick. Where's Josh?
I'm here.
Oh, you just weren't saying anything.
You've been having some connection issues, Josh?
I have, all night. Kicking me off.
Yeah, now here's the story about D-Von's looking for his information. WWE's vice president reportedly sold off 5% of his stock this morning. He was selling away some of his stock. You think he's beginning to realize that WWE's turned into the Titanic?
I think if WWE can pull off these matches that we're hearing about WrestleMania and, hell, even Fastlane, I think they may be able to go on a few more months off of that. Because John Cena versus Rusev, you can tell that's going to be a really hyped match. It's going to be a really good match, too.
Mm-hmm. And here's the story.
I think a Fastlane should be for the United States title.
Chances are it's going to go
into no, WrestleMania. It's probably going to be the United States title at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
And Cena's going to win the U.S. title.
Yeah. Woo!
At least it's better than being a 16-time
world champion.
John Cena
drops to a mid-card slot? What?
Well, this is what fans don't get. Cena for the second year is not in a main event spot for a title at WrestleMania. This year he's going to be in a mid-card match for a mid-card title with a mid-card guy, and they're building Roman Reigns to be the new face of the company and pushing Cena slowly out, and people are complaining about it. Why?
Yeah, believe it or not, this is good. This is good for WWE and good for John Cena.
Because Reigns isn't ready to be the face. He's not ready.
Hold on, guys, sit down.
Hold on, Stephen, calm down. Okay, listen here. You're saying that now. You know, I completely understand where you're coming from, but what happens if at WrestleMania Roman pulls off this 5-star match? And I'm just pulling off a bunch of what ifs. What if that happens? I think that we'll all be shocked. We'll all be happy. Steven might not be. We'll all be, and that could be the big shocker.
We're gonna see at WrestleMania. The only thing we're gonna see at WrestleMania is Roman Reigns getting German suplex for the whole match, and then he does his comeback. Brock Lesnar goes for an F5, hits a kick out. Roman Reigns hits Superman, but it's not gonna be a 5-star match. I can see it now because Brock Lesnar doesn't have any offense. It's just superplex. That's it.
Okay, now hold on. People said the same thing about the triple threat match. People said it was gonna be all Lesnar throughout the match, and no, that's not how it happened. Okay, it got to the point where no one could guess what it was gonna be, and it was an awesome match. It surprised people. You could be surprised, and you know, I know where you're coming from guessing about this, okay? It's reasonable, okay? At first, I thought it was going to be a bad match, too, but the more I thought about it, the more I thought you could experiment with this kind of match. With Roman Reigns versus Brock Lesnar, it could be something that we've never seen before, and it could be a shocker.
Well, let me interject.
Here's the other thing. I found it.
Go ahead, D-Ron.
It says, despite how Daniel Bryan was booked at last night's WWE Royal Rumble pay-per-view, and this news came from before the Rumble happened, it said that Vince McMahon is completely sold on Bryan and is shocked at how Bryan has been able to maintain his big babyface crowd reactions while off TV for so long. A WWE source noted that Vince and other top WWE officials might not consider Bryan the face of the company. Vince is still very impressed with him. On a related note, there was some speculation about Bryan being hurt after his first match back on Raw against Bray Wyatt. Word is that he did not re-injure his arm, and people backstage were actually saying he looked very sharp in the ring. With that said, Bryan's arm is still not 100% from before. So basically, wow.
That actually makes sense when you think about it. They're trying to protect Bryan. Because you remember last time he was in the main event, he got injured and was out for 9 months. You don't want to see that happen again. So that's smart. Because if he looks hurt and he has the opportunity to main event WrestleMania again,
then don't bring him back if he's still hurt. Why'd they bring him back if he's still hurt then?
Probably because he wanted to come back.
You're not ready.
Okay, well, Steven, I'm confused. Now you're saying Daniel Bryan should main event WrestleMania, and now you're saying you shouldn't have come back at all. No, I'd like to point out that no one in WWE is at 100%. Okay, when you go out there every week and or some people every day in the house shows and fight, you're never going to be at 100%. Never, ever. I don't care if someone says, I'm going to be 100% heading this fight. No, you're not.
No, instead of building up Bryan to return at the Rumble, they already had him competing before the Rumble, which was really – it just turned down his momentum because, again, Vince likes to strut his ego and ruin everything. They ruin Reigns. Don't get me wrong. Reigns is excellent in the ring, but when it comes to promos and stuff like that and who he faces off with, it's just terrible. Like, him against Big Show is not something I want to see. I know they can place Roman in a bigger match than that.
Well, let me interrupt here. I think that Josh, Stephen raised a valid point. Now, is Roman Reigns ready for the main event WrestleMania? We don't know. Only time will tell. They got, 2 months to build up on this matchup between Roman Reigns and Brock Lesnar. If Brock Lesnar does it, well, we're in January, February, going into WrestleMania's in March or April.
April, I think.
It's in March.
So I think we got about.
It is.
It's in March. Yeah, it's in March 29th, I believe.
Yeah, finally back in March this year. We got about 2 months almost to the date.
Yeah, I think what we have to understand and realize is, they got 2 months to build. Let's see how WWE does this. We know that, first of all, Mr. McMahon needs to stop writing promos for Roman Reigns. Because let's face it. Let's face it. Roman Reigns can't do a promo. Best thing he could do, I have to say that, be the silent killer. Be silent. Let your actions speak for you.
Believe that.
Do not be up there to tell a fairy tale again. Because I saw this photo last night. It says, once there was a man named Roman who needs to tell Roman he needs to stay away from the microphone. And I think overall, though, I get the overall event of the Royal Rumble, the Royal Rumble pay-per-view itself, I had to give it a B. Because it did have some good moments in it. Miz and Miz down. I think they're gonna split soon.
The Rumble match actually did have a lot of good moments. It's just when Daniel Bryan got eliminated, that's when the crowd got pissy, and that's when the match started to go downhill. But the Rumble match itself did have some good moments. Like, for instance, the Miz and Miz out thing. For one, that was awesome. I love how they played it out. And
let's not forget Bubba Ray surprised all of us.
Actually, yeah, Bubba Ray, DDT, the crowd popped for T. And then near the end, I know that you guys may not agree with me, but I loved how they had the Shield, Roman Reigns and Dean Ambrose against Big Show and Kane. I liked how they had that whole thing going.
True. Now, I'm going to read this article to you. Major Royal Rumble Backlash, # cancel WWE top worldwide trend. WWE fans worldwide are enraged over Sunday night's Royal Rumble pay-per-view, specifically Roman Reigns standing tall when all was said and done. The live crowd gave Reigns a thunderous rejection even before the match was over in a scene that rivaled last year's Batista Rumble incident. The backlash is continuing online, with WWE fans canceling their WWE Network subscriptions en masse. And # cancel WWE Network was the number one worldwide trend on Twitter for a good period of time, late Sunday evening and into Monday morning. One comment on Twitter said, think Michael Cole will let us know tomorrow that Hashtag cancel WWE Network is trending worldwide. Hashtag Royal Rumble. And then another one said, many fans were tweeting screenshots of the cancellation page after they dumped the network, with others saying the cancellation page crashed at one point. A poll on WWE's Facebook page with over 23,000 votes had 75% of fans giving the show thumbs down. And even Stone Cold Steve Austin was getting blown up with emails. 300 emails in 15 minutes. You ain't got to get hot about it. Hashtag Royal Rumble. Hashtag Steve Austin Show. See, like I said, the way WWE had this booked, the way how they booked the Royal Rumble was just a complete disaster. It was awful. When even a rock can't save the show, that's when you got a problem. And you got a huge problem. And Vince McMahon is out of touch. He don't know what he's doing. And I think he's getting senile.
I think that's one thing we can all agree on. Vince needs to pass the torch to Triple H, would be my first choice. Then you have some other guys that work for the company that know what they're doing. JBL, I know it's a long shot, but I think he knows how to book. He did good with NXT for a while.
Yeah, he was the general manager.
Yeah, and he did good with NXT. There's no lie about that.
Hold on. JBL didn't book NXT, neither did William Regal.
He did book some matches.
It was all Triple H.
No. When JBL, you didn't know this because I didn't know this until recently. JBL did help book some matches whilst he was the general manager. He was involved in quite a bit of backstage stuff. That doesn't surprise me.
Well, I think
if his, I could, I'd find I you. His...
Go ahead, Josh.
If I could, I'd find you the link. But the thing is, I saw that like a month ago, and I can't exactly remember what the link was.
I got some comments for you. One said, Roman has to turn heel ASAP after this. And then another person said, Brian sucks. That's a damn Brian.
He doesn't have to turn heel.
That's nice and that's nicely detailed, I have to say.
He does not have to turn heel. Roman does not have to turn heel.
No, Roman
that
shouldn't
is, cause turn heel. They did that last year with Batista. And
it didn't work.
No.
I think Roman Reigns can get really over if he turned heel.
He could, not when he's facing Brock Lesnar.
Brock Lesnar is like the hugest babyface right now after this past week.
Yeah, but that just because he does this face stuff, and second of all, he was in Philly. They always cheer the bad guys. The thing is, when Brock Lesnar attacked the Authority, that was not a face turn in the slightest. That was nowhere near a face turn. That was just Brock Lesnar kicking ass. Brock Lesnar doesn't care who he's facing. I think it's safe to say Lesnar will never be a face in WWE. He will never be a full-fledged face. He can't, because he's the big bad monster who destroys everything in his way. He's not like the Big Show or Mark Henry or Kane. He's different than all of them. He's some guy who cannot be a face because it wouldn't work.
Stay tuned. We have more of the CAW Roundtable in just a moment.
Yeah.
Welcome back to the CAW Roundtable. Let's continue on with the conversation from wherever our fellas left off.
Just because he gets cheered doesn't make him a face.
Oh, well, technically, if the fans choose who the heels and who the faces are, let's be honest now.
Well, yeah, but I mean, that's like saying when John Cena gets booed, that makes him a heel.
That's because no, he's creative is going to allow that. Doesn't make him a heel.
Yeah, and the thing is, John Cena, he shouldn't turn really heel either, okay? Because if he turns heel, then what's next for him after that one quick round?
You know how over Cena will get as a heel? People have been wanting this for ages for Cena to turn heel.
Yeah, but
he was probably the biggest heel. If Cena turns heel, it's only going to be when he's nearing the end of his career at this point.
Definitely.
It's only going to be then, and it's only going to be against a guy who they want to replace him.
And I still think Cena has about maybe 15 more years left.
Now, he's not going to wrestle when he's like Ric Flair's age, let's be honest. His injuries are getting more and more numerous. He's getting hurt more often. That's why they're putting him in less big-time matches now. I'm pretty sure they're going to stop doing that. That's why they want Reigns as the next face so quickly.
Which he isn't ready, by the way, Reigns.
Guys, let me interject. Like
Reigns, Rusev, Rollins.
I'm telling you, Daniel Bryan is the next big face.
Okay,
yes,
guys,
he is.
Let me interject.
You're not going to get like me. Daniel Bryan, Roman Reigns, Seth Rollins, all these guys that you see making their way up and start to appear more in the main event, they're the future of WWE, and I think that's awesome how they're giving these guys.
If there's an order, hold on. If there is an order of the faces, it would have to be Daniel Bryan, Seth Rollins, Dean Ambrose, Dolph Ziggler, and at the five spot, then it will be Roman Reigns.
Wow, you gonna put him down that low?
Yeah, he is not ready whatsoever. Actually, he needs about another year.
Well, I won't go with a year for him to be that big guy, okay? Because it took him not long after the show broke up to be the guy that everyone loved. It took him like what, less than a month?
But here's the thing. Remember, Roman Reigns was injured.
Yes, he was injured
last year.
He was injured and was out for months. But
Josh, when he got injured, I think that's what took some of the wind away from his sails. Took some wind away from his sails when he was out for a while. And I think once he came back, this is the thing. Let me finish. Here's the thing. It's not that fans hate Roman Reigns. It's the fact that WWE is pushing Roman Reigns down people's throat that's causing a major problem. And some of the fans they just are fed up about it. Last night in Philly, there was a major uproar because majority of them wanted to be on the side of Daniel Bryan. They want to see Daniel Bryan win the Royal Rumble. They want to see anyone win the Royal Rumble other than Roman Reigns. And once they realize that Roman Reigns is going to be the one that's going to win the Royal Rumble, that's what caused them to be just flat up upset, and that's what caused them to just boo the roof off the building. I think that's just the best way I could put it. That's the best way we could see it. And I think unless Vince McMahon opens his ears, and at least give a listening ear to the universe, unless he does that,
It's past that. He's got to give up. He's got to give the position up because it's way past. He's already hurt himself. He's made people literally send death threats to the poor old man. Okay, the thing is that Vince McMahon, he needs to pass the torch right now, as soon as possible. Otherwise, when he dies, and God please forbid this, but when he dies, there's going to be a whole lot of people saying, thank God. And I really hope that that's not what it turns out to, but that's what it's going to be if he keeps on doing this. Because there's going to be these crazy, egomaniacal wrestling fans being saying, thank you for taking him away. Now I'm finally someone's going to take over, okay? And you know there's going to be people to say that. And I really hope that's not what his death turns into. I hope people respect him. I want him to be the most respected man in the company because you know all that he's done. He made WrestleMania. He's the reason WWE wears today. But the thing is, he's gotten to the point where now he's the guy. Now he's the reason that it's falling down.
Let me interrupt you for a moment, John. I just saw something on Twitter. WrestlePlus1 has tweeted, WWE stocks dropped 5%. Dang, 5%. 50,000 people canceled the network, lost 2.7 million. Oh. And then he encouraged them to keep it up.
By the way, right now, again, once again, trending number one at worldwide is hashtag cancel WWE Network. Again.
Mm-hmm. This is ugly. Wait, it's gone back down. It's gone back down.
It's number two.
Are you sure? Because right now, hashtag Chikara Snow Day is number two.
I see cancel WWE Network at number one right now.
Okay, we're going to be refreshing this page a lot. Okay, now it's up. Now it's canceled WWE.
Let's see. Now, he says, I got another tweet for it. It says, this hashtag cancel WWE Network stuff is ridiculous. Y'all sound like a bunch of upset teenagers after mommy and daddy take away the car privileges. And then another person tweeted, how insecure must you be to edit so much of your fan reactions at WWE, hashtag cancel WWE Network? And then another person tweeted, he tweeted this at the start of the show. It said, we are just moments away from crowd editing, hashtag cancel WWE Network. Anyone notice that during the World Rumble, you know, replay on tonight's round that some of the crowd was being edited out?
Yeah, because they were chanting words that can't exactly be on a PG show. So some of that.
Well, I heard on Raw that they were chanting.
You shouldn't be hearing bullshit in a. They actually did chant that.
I heard that they had some of that in, like, because you know Philly crowd is unstoppable.
They tried to get some of it out though, because like. I know you're going to be like, oh, Josh, you have to go back on the Attitude Era when they were allowed to say that. No, you shouldn't be having the word bullshit in a PG show. I'm sorry. I give them credit for trying to edit that out.
Oh, let the people know.
When there's kids watching a PG show, I agree with
you. Oh, my God. They're going to be growing up saying the same thing, becoming the same type of
people. That does not mean that they should have to hear that when they're trying to watch a kid's show, okay? And, yes, I just said WWE is pretty much a kid's show. It's a PG show. That means there's lots of kids watching it. And let them scream that all they want. They don't – I mean – let them do it, but don't. It doesn't have to be on TV.
Let's see. I got another one for it. Says, this hashtag cancel WWE Network stuff has gone too far. I'll always keep my unconditional loyalty to WWE. I'll never stop being a fan. Hashtag one.
And what I read earlier today, this morning, Hulu. The other networking thing, they're actually plugging their network saying you can, and they actually used the hashtag cancel WWE Network. They said, when you cancel WWE Network, come over to Hulu for $7.99 and you can watch NXT here.
Oh, Lord.
Hey, at least they're not getting on their hands and knees and begging people to stay, okay? Because that's just like class. You gotta have class. I mean, they could be like, no, please stay with us. Don't leave us. We need your views. Nope. They're just like, they're giving you the middle finger when they do that.
Yeah, screw you. Goodbye. But here's another one. It says, sorry, but hashtag... Yeah, it says, sorry, but hashtag Gilmore Girls is on at Netflix. Hashtag cancel WWE Network at WWE. Dang, this person would rather for to watch Gilmore Girls than Raw? That tell you something.
Well, actually, it tells you that one person doesn't like watching WWE anymore. Whoop-de-doo! Oh, no, the WWE is screwed. That's like saying because Tom Brady got his feelings hurt, that means he's going to leave.
Let's see. Even Mick Foley said or asked on Twitter, and I know I posted this earlier. He said, does the WWE actually hate their own audience? I've never been so disgusted with a pay-per-view.
Well, wait, hold on. What can they do? Change the event halfway through because Daniel Bryan got eliminated? Now, sure, it wasn't the best idea.
They did change it when Daniel Bryan got eliminated. The Rock was never scheduled to come out.
I know, but yeah, I'm talking about the outcome of the match, though. Okay, they can't exactly because I mean, people knew people were gonna be bitchy because Daniel Bryan got
actually,
out.
Actually, Steven, The Rock was scheduled to come out and give Roman Reigns that endorsement regardless. It wouldn't have mattered. It wouldn't have mattered.
That's not what I read.
That's what I read.
Well, that depends where you read it from.
Yeah.
Okay, let me interrupt, guys, because I saw something on Twitter. I just saw this picture on Twitter. Someone replaced The Rock and Roman Reigns' heads.
I saw that.
Someone replaced The Rock's head with Scooby Doo, and they replaced Roman Reigns' head with Scrappy Doo. That's kind of funny, but I think that's the thing. I mean, fans are outraged, and some of the fans, yes, they're going to complain about it. There's not much else we can do about it. They're going to complain. They're going to complain, complain, complain. The best thing WWE could do is fix the product, make the product better. The only way they can make the product better, however, Vince McMahon needs to step aside.
Yeah, we can all agree on that, except I would probably agree in a different way that we heard Steven say earlier. Steven said that he should be put down, which I do not agree with.
Wait a minute, I don't think we need to put Vince to sleep.
I know, because Vince, you know, like I
it's
went on to Steven.
Put Vince to sleep. It's time to put him asleep.
Steven is a heartless motherfucker, apparently, ladies and gentlemen.
he's a human being, Steven.
No, he needs to be put down. He is the most hypocritical person I've ever met in my life.
You've met him?
He is.
I think we need to call the cops.
Seeing. He is. Oh, my God. If I could see Vince McMahon in person right now, I'd look him in their eyes and say, you are the most hypocritical person I've ever met, and I would slap him in the face.
Well, that's different than killing a man.
See,
okay, I think we learned today that Steven takes wrestling too far.
Hey,
crap.
Growing up, ever since I was born, I've been watching this. I've been watching the program. I never missed one Raw. Well, I missed a couple, but I recorded it. And with seeing how it's going, I just don't like it. And if I don't like it,
well,
I'm going to get fined.
Well, let me interject. Let me interject because growing up, I used to watch. I'm 34, by the way, but I used to watch Wrestling Challenge, Superstars. They also did WWF Primetime and Saturday Night's Main Event. I used to remember watching those shows, and I was entertained. You know, back then, with Hulk Hogan, Macho Man, Randy Savage, Undertaker, Brutus the Barber, Beefcake Sid, Justice. I can go on and on. But, I mean, just to where they are from then till now, it's sad that Vince McMahon's mind is stuck in the 80s. I mean, for example, look at what he did to the Ascension. He just totally made the Ascension into, like, half Demolition, half Legion of Doom.
See, WWE... NXT, when Triple H had the Ascension in the palm of his hand. The Ascension was an unstoppable team in NXT. He gave that team to Vince McMahon for Raw, for the main roster, and they buried
They buried the Ascension on Raw for Union, and they tried to make up for it at the Royal Rumble when they faced the New Age Outlaws, which really didn't help them at all.
And this thing, let me also interrupt again. This is the thing which I feel for when Adrian Neville comes up, you know, to the main roster. Because I read a couple of dirt sheets.
Don't feel for him yet. Don't feel for him yet, okay? I don't feel bad for someone until I see someone them actually get wrong. So I'm not going to feel bad for him yet. If I see him come out, here I come to say this, I'm like, dude, your career is over. Which, you know,
if I was Adrian Neville, I would be like, no, I'm not going to the main roster because I know what type of show that is.
I would wait until Mr. Main leaves.
Yeah, here's the thing. Because the plan was that to make Adrian Neville have a Mighty Mouse gimmick. Kind of like, you know, Mighty Mouse. You know, a lot of strength for a small body. Most people said that it was mostly talking about his ears and blah, blah, blah. But the thing of it, I can't get this figure out. Is Miss McMahon is out of touch. He's thinking of it. And I like that video. I think Steven posted a link to the video of the song from Hall and Oates called Out of Touch. But Mr. McMahon in it.
Oh, yeah.
But
it did.
Mm-hmm. And I think this is the thing. And this is the message which WWE is, you know, I think the message which the fans are trying to send to WWE. We know who's booking Raw. We know who's booking SmackDown. And we know that he's doing a very horrible job. Now, Steven, we don't need to put him to sleep. But we don't need to kill the guy. But Vince McMahon needs to step aside. Seriously, he needs to step aside. He needs to retire. Time has come for him to turn the reign over to Triple H, let Triple H run the company. Mr. McMahon, all he has to do is just fade into the background and just leave it alone.
Maybe he's make a guest appearance here or there. Get a huge
clap. He can do that. But here's the problem. Mr. McMahon won't do that. His ego won't let him do that.
No, because we all know. He is a McMahon. He has an ego. All of them do. Stephanie does. Shane does. Mr. McMahon Sr. did. All the McMahons have a huge ego, and it's taking over.
Mm-hmm. Now, here's the thing that I'm predicting what's going to happen if Vince McMahon doesn't act fast. At WrestleMania, if they don't build Roman Reigns to a top level where John Cena is right now, or Daniel Bryan, which he's not, because Roman Reigns, I would go to say he's probably with maybe Zack Ryder at that level, maybe.
Stop the tape. Whoa, I would not go that low, Steven. Holy crap, you want him to job? Holy crap, like, oh my,
how much do you hate Roman Reigns?
Like, seriously, I was only kidding. I only said that for reaction from Josh. I would say Roman. I think Roman Reigns is at the level of, let's go with Cesaro. Fans like him, but again, Vince is just holding Cesaro back when he was the top guy last year, or one of the big guys that the fans were rooting for to get a huge push. I mean, he won that Andre the Giant Battle Royal. But going back to the thing, if they don't put Roman Reigns at the top level where Daniel Bryan is, or John Cena is, they're going to boo Roman Reigns out of that arena at WrestleMania, and they're going to cheer their asses off for Brock Lesnar to win that match. And you know what's going to happen, right? Roman Reigns is going to win that match because Brock Lesnar's contract is up after WrestleMania, and I don't think he re-signed at all. So once he wins that match, there's going to be a lot of boos. So the one thing they're going to save it is with Seth Rollins cashing in, hopefully that he successfully cashes in and wins the title. That's the only thing that can save Roman Reigns' career and Vince McMahon's job.
Unless they do that stuff we were talking about. They push Roman Reigns to the moon within 2 months. If they can do the impossible and give Roman Reigns that John Cena feel or that Stone Cold feel or that The Rock feel within 2 months, then it's possible to have a great WrestleMania match. It'll be hard, but I do think that it is possible, even with Mr. McMahon. You're going to call me crazy? You get, huh?
But here's the problem, Josh. Here's the problem. I remember John Cena's first WrestleMania when he took on JBL. John Cena had months in the building up to the Royal Rumble and then winning the Royal Rumble. Because remember, John Cena was the United States champion at that time. He had months building up for that opportunity. And then when that opportunity finally came, he had the fans in his corner when he beat JBL at WrestleMania. Now, we're at WrestleMania 31, I think. WrestleMania 31. It's going to be in... It's going to be at Levi Stadium in San Francisco, California. And I think here's the thing. Here's the main thing I think WWE needs to consider. WWE needs to find some way to build up Reigns, build him up. So, I mean, let's face it. The Royal Rumble, can we all just admit that the Royal Rumble match was poorly booked?
Yeah.
Can we all agree to that? You know, that the Royal Rumble match was poorly booked. And, you know, if it's a great idea on paper, it's a great idea, you know, for Roman Reigns to win the Royal Rumble on paper. But when it's poorly executed, there's no excuses whatsoever. Coming up, DCA Revelations. We'll tell you, we'll have our preview of that CPV coming up right here on the CAW Roundtable. Welcome back to the CAW Roundtable. Let's continue on with the conversation for wherever our fellas left off.
Well, I actually think the match I'm looking forward to the most is going to be Tyler King and Gage Grayson, the Blade Runners, in the Tag Team Championship match because Josh McCloud pretty much grew up in the same... He just rose at the same pace, you know?
Well, I think that it's going to be a very good matchup. I'm looking forward to the main event myself. I'm looking forward to... Now, I'm pretty sure everyone in backstage in DCA is crossing their fingers and hoping that KC Gordon doesn't win the title. Because if he wins the title, that means that the Blacklist... And the Blacklist said they're going to be there. But DCA's days might be numbered. And if that happens, oh boy, that's going to be some major, major headache. That's going to be some major headache for DCA if Shazeen returns. And just in case, D.Y., if anyone hasn't heard of Shazeen, why don't you explain to us Shazeen? Keep it kindly, D.Y., keep it kindly.
Shazeen Freya. Former, I guess you can call it general manager, founder, president, whatever, of Allure Wrestling, which was an all-women's league. Great promotion. I'm sure a lot of you have heard of it. Great promotion. Really great. Was that promotion died at the hands of Shazeen. Ran it in the ground, as people would say it. Went into obscurity for a while, Shazeen did. Until episode 7... of DCA, when she arrived and announced that she would be co-GM of Takedown until she became full owner of DCA after driving Dwayne Thomas out. led the company DCA almost into the ground with the change, which was made of Alexander Washington, Dean Allen, and Travis Brooks side until Redemption, when Alexander Washington and Dean Allen got unceremoniously, well, they gave the titles to the Blade Runners, and then Shazine, in a backdoor deal, released Travis and Dean from their contracts. Fast forward all the way to Gateway to Heaven when John Blackrose showed up after Anthony Lewis couldn't make it to the arena for the title match with Jacob Cross, was inserted into that match after a masked member of the Change who won the Gateway to Heaven briefcase earlier in that night attacked Jacob viciously, left him barely able to stand up on his own two feet, and it was John Blackrose who ended up becoming world champion and revealed himself to be the leader of the Change, which Josh did not like.
No, I don't like, because I keep getting cut off.
And also, after that, the board decided to take executive action and tried to have Richard Sylvia, who was owner at the time, take Shazine out of her contract, but that did not happen because he left it to Amber Stevens, and it was supposed to be an MMA rules steel cage match between Amber and Shazine until I stepped in, reconstructed the board of directors, and Shazine was fired.
Yeah, I think that was the reboot. Episode of Richard Press, the reset.
Yeah, 29.
Mm-hmm. And I think that what we have to understand is that I guess Shazine, can you imagine if Shazine comes back into power in DCA? I mean, that's something which I'm pretty sure even you don't want to fathom.
Well, I mean, Casey Gordon was injured at Redemption in a Hell in a Cell match with Anthony Lewis. Thought we'd never see him again. Came back, declared that he would be DCA world champion. Little did we know that Shazine actually signed Casey to a contract to a manager to be Casey's manager long before she got fired. So technically that means that Shazine was never fired. She was only fired as general manager. She wasn't fired as a DCA employee. So that is how she was able to keep her job.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Shazine is running a new group called the Blacklist, which is comprised of two groups, one in CCL and one in DCA, because she's contracted to both. CCL, she's got Casey Gordon as the world champion, who won the world title in only his second match there. And hold on 1 second.
Now, I'm going to give my little opinion on this. It seems like that Shazine, she has more power now than when she was with the Change. Because right now she's taking over two companies.
Yeah.
Well, I think that...
Sorry.
Yeah, that's a good deal.
Sorry, I had a little interruption there. She's running in CCL. She's got Casey Gordon as the world champion, CCL world champion, which many people did not like because people thought that it was me. They're saying, oh, DCA, DCA. No, it's not DCA. It's Shazine. If you want to hate somebody, hate Shazine. Don't hate me. And you got CCL national champion Mark Austin. You got the Neo Diva Revolution, who Shazine knows very well because they were in Allure with her. Those are the four that are part of the Blacklist as we know it right now. Who knows who else she's got signed. And then on the other side of the coin, you've got in DCA already, you have Casey Gordon because he's assigned to both companies. You have Aleka Lynch and you have Delia. And you have the Wolfpack, who is also in CCO, signed to DCA. They're getting contracts as we speak right now, negotiated with Shazine. they are also on there going to be at DCA Revelations as well. She has promised that every single Blacklist member already will be at Revelations to help Casey Gordon win the world title.
And you know
she's
that
promised
means,
it. So that means you've right? got uh-huh. you got Casey, you've got Mark Austin, you've got the both Nevo Diva Revolution. That's four. Then you got 5, 6, 7 of the Wolf Pack. Then you got 8, 9, Delia and Nalika. That's and then you got Shazeen. That's 10. You got 10 people, 10 of the Blacklist total that are going to be at Revelations to help him win the world title. 10-on-2. How is that going to work?
It's definitely looking and when you look at it at that point of view, but think about it. You know, nobody else on the DCA roster likes the Blacklist. So you're going to have...
How do we know that some people on the DCA roster aren't under Shazeen's payroll already?
That's a good question.
You don't know. Nobody knows. Shazeen isn't going to tell anybody. So who? You don't know. Who could show up at Revelations and say, I'm a member of the Blacklist, because every person that Shazeen has managed has went on to be a champion. Alexander Washington, managed by Shazeen, became the longest reigning Destiny champion in history.
John Blackrose, for instance.
John Blackrose got handed the world title in his very first appearance.
That's right, on his debut in DCA.
On his debut, he was the world champion because of Shazeen. Travis Brookside and Dean Allen, they were tag team champions. Well, they were going to be tag team champions. Handed them to the Blade Runners. The Blade Runners, in their first title match, got those tag team titles thanks to Shazeen.
Mm-hmm.
Booted them out. Blade Runners came in, got the tag titles thanks to Shazeen. How long have they been champions? They've been champions since February of last year.
Several months. Oof. Almost a year.
Yes, almost a year.
Yeah, we're closing on the year.
Almost a year as tag team champions, thanks to Shazeen.
And
Casey Gordon,
it.
In his second match in CCL, became their world champion. Second match. He became their world champion. Neo Diva Revolution, CCL Women's Tag Champions, thanks to Shazeen. How do we not know that Shazeen and all of her influence and all of her money that she's gathered from these companies can't go to one certain superstar who's been on the lowest level of the totem pole and say, I can take you to the top of the mountain, and they go, yes, I'll do it, because that is exactly what kind of influence
she
has at this point.
To be fair, who wouldn't want to jump at the opportunity?
Exactly.
If you told that you could be a world champion inside of a week, who would not jump at it?
A champion. You don't have to. It could be the DCA World Championship. It could be the Destiny title. It can be the tag titles. It can be the women's title. Hell, she can get a contract to CCL. She did it with Casey. She did it with Casey. You know, over there, be their world champion, national champion. Women's tag champion, women's champion, bombshells champion. It doesn't matter. If you're with Shazeen, you are handpicked to be a success. And even then, you know, she doesn't even have to make you a champion. Just being with Shazeen gets you recognized all together at this point. That's how big Shazeen is at this point now. Shazeen has gotten to the point where she is even more popular than she was in Allure, and not popular as in a good thing. I mean popular as in a bad thing. That's how much influence she has on whoever she can get her hands on. She can take a normal, lower card guy and bring him or her up to the top of the mountain.
The thing about Shazeen is that she's become the Paul Heyman of DCA. Now it's...
I was about to say she was coming to female Bobby Heenan.
Yeah, Bobby Heenan. She's taking all her ability and stretching it to CCL. Who knows what league it could go to next? What if it infects another league?
WCW or whatever it's going to be called now. So who knows what she's going to do? Yeah. She could influence them.
Well,
that's true. That is very true because...
let's be honest with ourselves. She could go to WTW.
Whoa! Hold up!
She's got money to do it. She's got money to do it. And do you think that your general manager or your company's big president, whoever it is. I don't really keep up with all that. But you, Josh, ask me this question. If Shazeen, with all her money, with all her influence, with all her power, goes up to the president of that company and say, I can make your company big, and I can bring the blacklist in and make it make your company a huge success, would they say no to all that money and all that attention?
No. There's only one man higher than Stone Cold Steve Austin in our company, and that's the anonymous COO of WTW. And I'm not sure who he is, but I'm beginning to think that even if Shazeen offered him or her the money that she, because she is the richest woman in CAW history, that is no doubt about it.
Let me jump in, because you know that's the saying, you know, everybody has a price. So
yeah.
Maybe Shazeen, yeah, everybody has price. So maybe Shazeen will say, well, name your price, I'll pay it.
Mm-hmm.
She could do it that yep. way. Yeah, she could do it that way. D-Wall, what's the link to the stream in which everybody go come see your show Saturday?
It's in the description box. We're too cheap okay. to put it in this video.
We can't
okay. But one more thing I will say. The Sylvias actually helped too. Because remember, the Sylvias brought her in. The Sylvias brought her in not knowing exactly what they were dealing with until it was too late. So that money she acquired from Allure, she acquired from the Sylvias, who are rich in itself. They are.
Yeah, that's how she got her money, pretty much. You can bet on that. That's how she got most of her money.
She has got, I can tell you right now, she's got a six-figure contract.
Oof. Well, I can be the first one to tell you. So, ladies and gentlemen, you got to tune in Saturday, 8 Eastern, 7 Central, at the stream. We'll have the link at the description. At the description where you could go. You need to see this show. Because the future of DCA may be hanging in the balance here. So you got to tune in. You got to see this show. And I think...
it is in the balance.
D-Wall, I think that... if my memory serves correctly, I think McCloud and I were doing the pre-show.
Yes. Pre-show.
And we're going to be on the pre-show panel?
Yes.
That's right. We're going to be there. Okay. We're going to be calling the action, mate. And possibly, you know, we may be getting involved with the fans, too.
Yeah. I believe it might be a live prediction show / pre-show. So, 6 p.m., you can go and join the stream. Be there early. And,
and
come get involved. Talk to us.
Yeah. Live prediction show, and there'll be a live post show after Revelations, which will feature me, Josh, Carter, you know, whoever else we can bring in, maybe Hakeem Johnson.
By the way, if you never heard Hakeem Johnson commentate, you need to watch his ACW show and stand by and be amazed.
Because that commentary is going to bring it's going to be in Revelations, and that commentary is going to be brought to every Takedown show next season. So, you know,
And you can join us back here on the CAW Roundtable. We're going to discuss the fallout from what happened at Revelation. Let me tell you something. If Shazeen's team comes out victorious, if Casey Gordon comes out victorious, I think DCA is going to be in serious trouble.
Well, let's just put it like this. Here's what Shazeen said, and I quote, on January 31st, DCA and CCO will burn and the blacklist will stand on its ashes. Oof. So, yeah, that's how much this match is. This match means to everyone involved. Malik Brown and Atlas Jones have already said that they are going to make sure that Casey does not walk out world champion, but it's 10 against 2. Mm-hmm. That's just how it is. And that's how, and I think that's what you and Josh and whoever else is going to be on the panel are going to talk about, is the fact that it's going to be 10 on 2 in this main event. There's no getting around it. Casey could, you know, he could be in trouble, and at any point, one member of the blacklist come out, two members of the blacklist, five members. It's no disqualification.
That's right.
Absolutely. It's no disqualification. They can do any, and who knows? They might get to them before the match even starts. Who if If I know Shazeen very well, they may take the world champion and Atlas both out before the match starts, even in the middle of the night, the beginning of the night, and then Casey could just be handed the world title. But then again, I think Shazeen would rather it be to where Casey pins one of them in the middle of the ring in front of the world.
Mm-hmm. Like we said, ladies and gentlemen, that's a lot can be at stake. You got need to get to that stream Saturday, 8 Eastern, 7 Central. You need to be there. So thank you, Josh and DeJuan, for joining me on this roundtable discussion.